Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining a basic configuration of MPLS on Cisco iOS routers. Now, don't forget to subscribe, to enable notifications, and to like this video if you like this video. And if you have questions or feedback, please write them in the comments below. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. As you will see very clearly in this video, MPLS is rarely configured alone. It is almost always deployed in combination with a whole series of other network protocols and features, including BGP, as well as the use of one or more IGPs, such as OSPF or ASes. Now, the topology that we'll be working with today is this one here. Now, let me explain a few things about what we're going to do. We have a topology that consists of three BGP autonomous systems. We have two customer sites where the CE1 router at the first site is found within BGP AS1, and the CE2 router is at the second site and it's found within BGP AS2. The ISP network consists of a single BGP AS with an AS number of 100. Now, all routers in the MPLS ISP network will have a loopback interface and an IP address configured on those interfaces. For now, I've only labeled the PE and the P routers that we will be dealing with along the expected MPLS path. But this is done for all PE and P routers in the ISP MPLS network. We'll see how those loopbacks are going to be used in our configuration. Then we'll configure an eBGP peering between CE1 and PE1, and another eBGP peering between CE2 and PE2. This is done so that customer networks, such as those ones here, will be advertised to the PE routers. Then we'll configure the OSPF underlay on all of the MPLS P and PE routers. We will then configure a full mesh of iBGP peerings between the PE routers. And finally, once all of that is done, then we'll enable MPLS. Well, let's get configuring. Now, the routing protocol between the CE and PE routers can actually be anything, but for the purposes of this video, I've chosen to use BGP. These will be eBGP peerings because the routers are in different ASs. We have the 10.10.10.0/24 network between these two routers, and the IP addresses of each interface are the .1 and .2 addresses. Now, because I've covered BGP configurations extensively in my BGP video series, I will just show you the configurations briefly here. You can check out my BGP videos in the links in the description below for more details. This is the configuration that essentially establishes the eBGP peerings between CE1 and PE1. And we have a similar configuration at the CE2 location between CE2 and PE2, and using the appropriate AS numbers and IP addresses of eBGP neighbors. Now, notice here that it is the customer network on the CE2 router that is being advertised. So these eBGP peerings will cause the CE routers to advertise their networks to the PE routers. Next, we configure the P and PE routers within the ISP infrastructure with OSPF, such that all routers within the topology can find each other and ping each other. In this configuration, we ensure that the loopbacks of all devices are also reachable by advertising them via OSPF. Now, this is vital because ultimately what we want is for LDP adjacencies to form between MPLS-enabled routers. And LDP adjacencies will always form between the loopback addresses by default, so they should be advertised by the IGP and reachable to each other. Now, here's a sample of the OSPF configuration that we would find within our PE1 router. We're advertising the loopback address as well as the network serving this link here. But notice that we are not advertising the network of the interface that connects to the CE1 router. This is where the OSPF domain ends. It doesn't extend into the CE at all. Ideally, we should configure that interface as a passive interface. so that no OSPF messages like hello messages are sent to the CE router at all. And here we see a sample OSPF configuration found within a P router. Here all networks on all interfaces are advertised as well as the loopback address. Now ultimately all IP addresses of all P and PE routers on physical interfaces and loopback interfaces, except those facing the customer edge devices, should be reachable from each other. So that's the IGP underlay configured using OSPF. Now that all of the P and PE routers are reachable to each other, we can configure iBGP peerings between all PEs. Now remember, BGP here is used to exchange customer networks only. For our topology here, we'll be looking at the iBGP peering that we'll establish between PE1 and PE2. Now to configure these peerings, we issue the following commands within each PE. We create the peerings between the loopbacks. That's one more reason why we created those loopback interfaces and why we want them advertised by the routing protocol. Since we're using the loopbacks, we must also use the next hop self command and the update source command. If you're not sure what those are, take a look at the related BGP videos linked in the description below. Now the P routers remain unchanged. They don't need to know about BGP because they won't be participating in it. They don't need to know the customer networks, but their OSPF configurations allow them to convey iBGP peering messages between the PE routers, allowing them to become iBGP peers and exchange routes. Now, I'm not sure if you realized that after all of that configuration, we haven't even started configuring MPLS. But not to worry, because enabling MPLS is actually among the simplest configuration steps in this process. Now, MPLS on Cisco devices is enabled on a per interface basis, and this is done by issuing the MPLS IP command on all interfaces within the MPLS core network. In other words, all interfaces except those facing customers. This essentially enables the LDP protocol and allows these routers to create LDP adjacencies and exchange labels. And after a few seconds, the topology should be converged. So here's the configuration on P2 as well as on PE2. So now all of these interfaces have MPLS enabled and LDP adjacencies are forming between the loopback interfaces. Now, if we ping from CE1's loopback address to CE2's loopback address, we will get a successful ping. But let's see what's actually happening under the hood. First, let's take a look at one of our P routers here. In the IP table, we don't see the source or destination address of that ping, and yet our ping was successful. That means that we're no longer using IP routing at this point in the topology, but we're using label switching, which is what we want. Secondly, let's take a look at our routing table for our destination within PE1. We can see here that in order to get to our destination from PE1, we need to get to the PE2 iBGP neighbor, which is indicated here by the 4.4.4.4 loopback IP address. PE1 learned about this customer route from its iBGP peering with PE2, and we can see that the next hop in order to get there is PE2 itself. Let's see what the LFIB tells us about how to get to that destination. Here we can see that the next hop IP of PE2 corresponds to label 17, with an exit interface of gigabit Ethernet 02 and a next hop IP of 10.10.20.2, which is that of this P router here. So this label is pushed and the packet is sent. Notice that the actual customer destination network doesn't appear anywhere in the LFIB. It's only the IP address of the destination PE that is seen, and the labels are used to get to that PE device. Now, I won't continue the verification steps on the rest of the P and PE routers in detail because we've seen those in previous videos, but I will just say that label switching continues to occur until you get to the last P router. At this point, Penultimate hop popping takes place, or PHP, where the label is popped or removed. Once that's done, it's sent to the PE2 router, which has a route to the destination, and it is sent to the destination using simple IP routing. So that, in a nutshell, is how you configure and verify MPLS. Now, it's amazing how the MPLS configuration is just a very small part of the whole configuration procedure because of the fact that you need routing to be configured between CEs and PEs and an IGP to be configured on the ISP infrastructure and BGP to be configured between all PE routers. And only then are you able to enable the functionality of MPLS to get the results you want. Anyway, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment below, and please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.